Well, we'll call this meeting to order. First thing is the approval of the agenda.
I would like to have one item removed from consent, please.
Okay.
The first item.
Very good. We'll move that to the regular agenda. We'll make it the first item.
I'll make a motion to approve of the change.
Second.
Oh, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
No citizens to be heard here. Payment of bills.
Move to pay the bills, Mr. Chair.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And with that, we'll take that first consent agenda item.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I asked that be removed, and it's with good timing because Kurt just walked in. And I think any time that we have any organization or individuals that contribute to our veterans or any thing for that matter should be publicly recognized rather than just put on consent. And I just wanted to make mention that Moorhead Thrift Shop had made that $300 contribution to the Veterans Service Office, and I think we should be thanking them for that contribution.
Okay. I just wanted to double check. Is that date right on that check?
I had a question in regard to that as well, I guess.
On the check?
Yeah, the first item on the donation. I don't know if you got that, that donation. It says September 1st, 2015.
15.
I think that's the 16th there.
I'd say that's the 16th.
Well, yes. Most of them are 15.
And well,
I don't
know, but there's some down below that are 16.
Yep.
On the same form, and I just wonder if the...
That's a running list, and the latest one is the recent.
Okay, so the thrift shop is the latest one?
Yeah.
Okay, it shows September 1st of 2015.
Yeah, I think there's a typo on the date.
Yeah.
And then also the date on the form itself, Kurt shows September 1st of 2015. And then here it's showing this is 9, but then there's some 16 down here.
Huh. That's a little
old.
Yeah,
I'll probably get after him. You have to get after him, but I just...
You can probably take care of that right now.
Yeah. Either way, we're appreciative.
I'm talking to myself. I'll
sit over here. Brian, the fact that this had been pulled off consent, does it need a motion, or isn't that necessary?
No.
Well, I don't think it does.
Thank you.
No. But, Mr. Chair, I apologize. We should have caught those dates on there. We'll make that adjustment in the future. So, thank you.
Now, with that, we'll go. Kurt, do you want to come up here? Service Officer Enhancement Grant and Resolution.
Well, first of all, my apologies on the dates. Brian shouldn't take that heat. That's me. So. We'll leave a little bit off of them today.
Just today.
Just today. Once again, the enhancement, operational enhancement grant of $12,500 is being offered to Clay County and paperwork and the grant agreements. I did close out TY16 recently, so that's why I can apply for 17.
Okay.
And we spent all of the $12,500 plus a little bit more. You have to be within $25, $12,475 or higher. Otherwise, you have to pay back the state. So they only have a $25 leeway. Mm-hmm. So I was throwing stuff in at the end like you wouldn't believe, because they were taking stuff. So we got her closed, and then I know better for next year. Just focus on big items.
What are some of the major things you use these for? I mean, just for the
well, mostly would be the second thing I'm here is to add a state travel approval, and that would be South Carolina was last year for nationals. That runs about $6,500 with plane and hotel for two, and then this year in June it's San Diego, and then advertising. We got the billboards up. I don't know if you saw them, ones in Buffalo Wild Wings.
Yeah, it looks good.
We do that, and then office supplies, kind of if we need a printer or a shredder. Yeah, it kind of, it adds up. I do have a budgeted list. And I'll probably attach or send to you guys, but I have to propose a budget to break down the 12.5 and the items that I'm requesting.
Thank you for taking the effort to apply for that.
I'll move to approve the resolution and the grant.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Okay.
Do we need to do out-of-state travel too?
I'll make a motion to approve the out-of-state travel.
All in favor?
Aye.
Otherwise, I'll come back in May and see you guys.
You got it.
Thanks, sir.
Mark, we talk about approval of security camera policy.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mark.
Okay, so a couple of months back, you approved the installation of some security cameras in our family service center. When those are being installed right now, we actually expect them to become operational sometime this week. Because of that, some questions have come up amongst different people, who can see what's on the cameras, what happens to the images. A lot of questions came up. So we put together a little group of people and we talked through all that, and we came up with basically a policy. We said we need to have something, some guidelines of who can see it, how long do we store it. Storage is a really big issue. We have several cameras on campus right now. Actually, I don't know how many. There's quite a few, but we don't store any imagery at this time. As soon as we store imagery, things start to change as far as public access to data, what's public, what's not. So we had to work through some of those issues, and Jenny was very helpful to us in figuring out what we should and shouldn't be doing with that. So at the end of the day, what we did was we came up with a policy that says if somebody needs to view the live stream from the cameras, because the cameras can be looked at live, there's not any central room that has a bunch of screens in it that are showing what's on these cameras. It's just the cameras are all doing their thing, and they're storing onto a data server. So the question was, who can look at what cameras are seeing right now live? So we had to basically decided that the best way to do that, we'll come up with a form that people could fill out, and they'll have to have some sort of a business reason on why they would like to see it and how long they're going to want to see it through that camera. And then the other question, probably the biggest one that we struggled with, was how much of this stuff do we store? From our point of view, we wanted to store as high a resolution imagery as we possibly can, so that if we ever have to go back and look at it, we can actually see what's happening on these cameras. And all these new cameras are pretty high resolution cameras. I mean, the imagery is pretty amazing what they can see. So we decided that to meet that need, as well as some of the other issues that we came up with as far as some privacy concerns, right now the policy reads we'll store data for only 5 days, unless, of course, there is a reason we need to keep it longer, like some kind of a court order or a law. Some sort of incident occurs, then we'll store that longer. Otherwise, it just keeps disappearing. That allows us to not have to worry about so much data storage space. It's probably one of the bigger concerns. Plus, there were some other questions about how do we really need to have it? Is there a reason we need to store it any longer? So that's really kind of where we came from with that. The new cameras that we're installing in the Family Service Center are at each of the doors to the Family Service, so every door to the building, the camera is viewing who's coming through the doors, as well as we also have some in the parking lots that show the parking lot areas. And those were done specifically in case something happens. You know, if there's an incident, we want to be able to have an image and we can go back and get it. But our decision or recommendation, I guess is the right term, is that if we don't know what happened in 5 days, we're probably not going to know ever. So, you know, it's the kind of thing that we're going to know right away. And so that's kind of how we've set that policy up.
Have we ever had a request to review the film?
No. No, and we've had some cameras in this building since it was remodeled in 2002. So we have, I think there's 33 cameras in the courthouse right now. We have a weather camera. It's been running on the outside of, it shows the courthouse itself. It's been running since 2000, and we've never had a request to view the imagery from that camera. But we don't store it either. so nobody's, well, I don't know which, that's, you know, that's a chicken and egg kind of question, but these new cameras, probably the biggest reason they're being installed is for security. So that if something does happen, we can go back and look at them. As well, I think there's also a deterrent factor to having, because now we've had signage installed on the building, on the doors, the family service center said that there's cameras in present, and when you walk in, you can see them hanging from the ceiling. I think that just those factors are quite useful. But we also had to figure out how do we best deal with this. And that's why we kind of came up with this plan, and I'm bringing it for you today for your consideration. And I would expect if it doesn't work, we can always come back and say, you know, we need to store longer, we need to store, I don't know if we'd ever go shorter, but I think that's kind of what we had.
Mark, is the, because you're talking about these recording in this high res, that obviously takes more space to,
right.
Is space an issue as to why we chose 5 days?
No, space isn't the issue at that kind of, you know, if we were going to be talking 30 or 60 days, then space would be an issue. But at 5 days, it's not really. That was not our biggest concern. I think our biggest concern was if we don't have a need to keep it, we don't want to keep it. It's kind of part of our whole records retention plans. You know, we have records here that, some records we have to keep forever, but we have records that have a lifespan to them, and we get rid of them on purpose because there's a reason we don't want to have them anymore.
I can see where, from anything internally, we should probably have some sort of an idea after 5 days. What I'm wondering about externally, a lot of times you see, you see news reports of police departments going back and reviewing videos, in some instances quite a bit later, where maybe they got new information about a child abduction or something like that, that they didn't, until they got a suspect in mind, and they didn't know where to go to look,
right,
to find out where they are, and sometimes that can take longer. Now, I'm not going to, you know, I'm not suggesting that would happen here, but I just, you know, there's some of those places that hold their security a lot longer, those tapes mm-hmm. a lot longer than we do, and I just didn't know.
Right. One of our concerns, you know, and this policy would apply to all of our security systems. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the Family Service Center, one of the concerns is there's quite a few activities in that building that are private, I guess would be. You know, people might not want to know that they're going there for a certain, by whatever reason that might be. I think that's one of the reasons we would try to limit how much of this stuff we store so that we can help protect those people's privacy if we need to.
Well, it's a public building.
It is.
It's a public building. And once they get in there and they're doing their business, they're doing it under what mm-hmm. should be private
right.
office space, but I guess we can try it and see what happens.
Well, Mr. Chair, our discussion centered around kind of the parking lot areas, because one of the concerns for security over at the Family Service Center is the hours that some of the staff are working,
right.
going to and from their cars.
Right.
So then we got into the fact that, okay, what goes on in parking lots sometimes? Is unknown, and if there is an assault or something, hopefully we'd know that in 5 days. So that's why we kind of come up with the 5 days longer. Certainly, your points are well taken, though.
Yeah. I'm not. I'm just wondering why.
Yeah.
If there.
That's kind of why we went with it, because we thought.
If you could have 10 days and it wasn't a data issue, why not have 10 days?
Mr. Chair, I think it was, I mean, largely driven from a legal perspective
okay.
as well, because
okay.
when we have that data, it's public data. So then we would have to entertain any request for that data. And employees, the image of an employee becomes personnel data, which is private. So we'd have to, if somebody made a request for data for the last 30 days, we'd have to go through 24 hours of video for 30 days and redact every face of every employee that's coming and going from work. In addition, there's other private data we'd have to, so I mean, it becomes an issue of managing that data. And
okay.
so that's, I think, I encourage that it be the least days possible to still preserve our safety interest.
Wayne?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. And what Brian said regarding the parking lot, that was a big issue in the building committee.
Right.
So, Mr. Chair, I move to approve the adoption of the security camera policy as presented in front of us today.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
Thank you.
Good work.
Thanks, Mark.
Mr. Chair, we're running a little ahead of schedule of we allowed for a longer discussion period here. And I asked Kirk if he was, if you, in the event, you want to move up.
Okay. Well, then, item number six, then, the Prairie Lakes Municipal Solid Waste Authority.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
One of our favorite subjects.
Yeah, one of my favorite subjects, anyway. I just want to let you know that I'm a record setter in the sense that, I don't know if you guys noticed, but they had a record-setting crowd on Saturday at the State Fair of 260,000 people.
And you were part of that.
I was part of that group, and I want to tell you, that was not fun at all.
They also had a record-setting crowd at Steam Threshers.
Did they?
Have attended. Yes, they did.
How many, do you remember? How many?
I don't recall the number, but it was, they all ran out of food early in the day.
They didn't run out of food at the State Fair. They did not run out of any beer either. It was a goat rodeo, too. It was terrible. It was really bad. Anyway, enough of my personal endeavors. I came before you today for two items. The first item is just kind of an overview of the budget for next year at Prairie Lakes. As you probably know, both Commissioner Campbell and Commissioner Whalen are part of the board. Commissioner Campbell is the primary representative from here. He's the chairman of the Prairie Lakes group, and he's also chairman of the finance group. I would say that we've come a long ways here in the last year as far as where we're at Prairie Lakes. I can start to see the light at the end of the tunnel, and no, it's not another train. It's actually, I think we're making some progress here. That having been said, I know you guys love numbers because this is the number time of year. It's pretty straightforward. I sent you the entire budget. It's pretty straightforward. All the counties have looked at it, and the board passed it last week, I believe it was, and approved the budget for next year. The takeaways that are important to Clay County are, first of all, the tipping fee is going to be moving from $94.50 to $102.50. It's a significant number. I do think I may have given Kevin some of his previous heart issues because I think that number should be higher. He thinks that we're in pretty good shape where we're at right now. I did cause some trouble there, I'm sure, but the reason I think the number should be higher than $102.50 is that the project is totally undercapitalized. We are making some progress if everything works according to Hoyle, then we should be in pretty good shape. My concern is that everything hasn't worked according to Hoyle. I think that there's some concern there. But at any rate, the tipping fee is going to be moving up to $102.50. I should remind the board here that the tipping fee only applies to 3,400 tons on an annual basis to Clay County. We are obligated to deliver 9,400 tons to the facility. And we are only charged a tipping fee on the last 3,400 tons, so that's where the impact for Clay County is going to be. So that's the one area that I want to let you all know about. The second area is on the I think it's on your second page on the bottom. Essentially, what is changing there is that in the past, some of the counties have not brought their fair share of material into the facility. And as a result, we've had some issues with coming up short on the tipping fee. And what Commissioner Campbell suggested, and I think this is an excellent suggestion, is that we basically are obligated 15% of 62,000 tons that are delivered to the facility. And each county is required to deliver X amount of material. And so what we've done is we've taken the total amount of material that each county is obligated, taken it times the tipping fee to find out their total obligation, and then divided it by 12. So beginning January of next year, each county will be paying on a monthly basis of what their obligation is. And again, I think it's a much fairer way to make sure that everybody pays what they're obligated, and that way we can hopefully be on top of things at the end of the year.
How did you determine how much each county is obligated by?
Mr. Chairman, the way it was worked out is in Clay County's example, we own 15%. Our obligation is 15% of the total budget. And so we took, I think it was 62,000 tons, basically, is what the budget is. And it's 15% of 62,000 tons. We took that times $102, and that's what our obligation is.
Mr. Chairman, before, what was happening is on a monthly basis, each county, with the exception of Clay County, was billed for the actual deliveries. And it worked that way throughout the year. And so if one county was short, say, by 500 tons, they didn't have to pay that. Or they weren't billed it. And hence, as you see on the budget that Kirk put as part of his packet, the tipping fees is the single largest revenue source that we have for that facility. And if one of our member counties falls short, then we obviously fall short in making our bond payments.
Can we haul more than we're talking?
Well, that question's been asked, and based on the 62,000, that's basically the capacity that can be run through the facility. So the answer is no to that question on a simple basis. There might be certain months where opportunities are better. There might have been some downtime, and every county is going to have some, what's the terminology for it, where we bypass, where the facility can't handle it, and then they have to bypass it, and then each county has to send it to another. Clay County, of course, will just keep ours and ours. But so if Becker County or Otter Tail County gets bypassed, then they have to pay another facility to send that there. And that's the other part of the equation, is we want to make sure that bypass is all fair to each county, because that bypass creates an additional cost to all counties. So.
I'm just thinking, if one county doesn't send their stuff, can we send more?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think one of the things at Clay County is that we have to remember we have the landfill. It's highly unlikely. I mean, if there was a need to take more material over there, we'd have a discussion among ourselves, but we still have to have volume into our landfill to fully provide funding for operation at that facility. So it's highly unlikely that we'd take any more.
Well, the other reason that's highly unlikely, Mr. Gross, is the fact that the Prairie Lake Solid Waste Board voted at its last meeting to do what Kirk's talking about here on that monthly payment issue. And really what that does is it tells every county, you better be delivering what you're supposed to be delivering, because you're paying for it anyway. You know, so that's going to encourage those who weren't delivering their fair share to deliver it, because we're making them pay. So there's no reason why we shouldn't see the 62,000 tons come in.
One other thing, Mr. Chairman, that you all should be aware of, each of the counties are involved with Prairie Lakes, are involved with the designation process. We're also involved with the designation process as well. We haven't done much here lately because we're waiting to move from volume-based to weight-based pricing. But once that occurs, all the waste that's generated within a specific county has to be taken to Prairie Lakes or a transfer station serving Prairie Lakes, so we'll be able to get a better handle at that point in time on different material. But I should point out again, I think that, you know, I think we've made a lot of progress on this, and, you know, Commissioner Campbell had a large part in helping ensure that that is done. So, you know, I think it's been good for Clay County that he's been involved with this.
I guess going back a little bit to my original question, you know, how did you determine that Clay County is 15% and by the amount of garbage we have, or just?
It's the percent that of investment that went into the facility, your percentage of ownership in the.
Mr. Chairman, essentially what happened is when we became part of Prairie Lakes, in exchange for $195,000, we got 15% ownership of the facility. And that's the way it was determined. Pizza ready?
It is.
Eggs ready?
Thank you for that explanation.
Sorry.
Sorry to interrupt.
I try and help as much as I can.
A little too much.
I'll let you go on.
So that's basically the answer there. I don't know that there's any, do we need to approve that, Kevin?
I don't think so. It's it's in your budget, so. Oh, okay, so, yeah, I think maybe what we ought to do is we should, and I would move that we agree and confirm with the Prairie Lakes board to go to the monthly billing.
Second.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Kevin is there?
Yes.
Is he out here?
Yes.
And I said, did you link what you got?
No, that's the next item.
That's the next item.
Pardon me?
No, that's right.
Thank you.
Okay, we got a motion to go to monthly billing as opposed to what we went quarterly before?
It was monthly, but it was based on usage. This time it's based on average.
Right. Very good. Okay, we have a motion. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Okay.
Okay, thank you. The second item, Mr. Chairman, is it's an item that came up before I actually started working here, and I worked with Jenny and Brian to try and resolve this issue. Essentially, it was an account that was delinquent, and in trying to get the money for the county, it was approximately $12,000. The individual claimed he was not the responsible party. He claimed somebody else was a responsible party, but we encouraged him to settle. He decided to settle. We decided that 50% of his what he owed was fair to the county and fair to us. From Iowa originally, where they always say half a hog is better than no hog at all. So with that, he's finally completed his obligation that we agreed to, and in order for us to take it off the books, we have to have it acknowledged by the county board. So I ask that you approve that.
Mr. Chair, what is the agreement amount?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, the agreed amount was $5,948. And essentially what he did is he made a payment of $500 a month, and he satisfied that amount.
Okay. So we need a motion to approve that?
Essentially to accept the, Mr. Chairman, to accept the agreement.
Okay, we got a motion. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Okay.
Thank you.
How much time do you need for budget?
We can do it in 15 minutes, I think, okay. Mr. Chair.
We got 15 minutes. Or do you need some more help? Are you waiting for Lori, or is the one man show today?
She's watching, so she'll be up.
One man show.
Depends on what you guys want to do.
There's a new and improved version here.
Improved it is. But that'll be, again, up to you.
Thank you.
Well, good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the board. It was 2 weeks ago that your last meeting was held, and we talked about the budget, and we had presented some ideas for reduction, and you had certainly supported, I told you, 1 minute. You had supported some of the concepts or the concepts that we were discussing and made some suggestions to it, so we followed your suggestions in working through the budget. So we went back to basically all of the departments, and as you had stated, you felt that the departments knew better where they could conserve a little dollars and things. So we'll just kind of run through what we have done so far with this and see if it meets with your approval of, and what you want to do. But the first one we'd like to talk about there, we'd like to talk about is you had new requests from the county attorney's office, and they were requesting, or Brian, Mr. Melton was requesting two new attorneys for 2017. And in our discussions with him, if it's satisfactory to you, he would reduce his request in half, and he'd like to still look at two attorneys being employed next year, and it would probably be, one would be April 1st and the other then would be October 1st. He can do that in 2017 with one position authorized, but he would be adding two attorneys, and I put that in my memo that you realize then that that creates an additional obligation for 2018 as you move into. But I think you folks were in agreement that he needs the help, and this would stagger the increase on getting those two attorneys on board and still assuring him that he's getting the personnel that he needs to do his job, and he's in agreement with that. So
I just have a comment in regards to that. I know that Jenny is often at our meetings, and I did have an opportunity to speak to one of our county attorney reps, and they are currently experiencing enormous caseloads, as you all know. But this one person in particular pulled all of the files to see where they were at, and they currently had over 300 open cases. And in comparison to what Hennepin County, for example, sees, they believe that when they get to a 100 caseload, that they are not able to adequately put the time and effort into those cases. And I want this board to really be aware as to where those people are at. And I understand there's a need, and I appreciate Mr. Melton's being flexible, but I just don't know how long we should stress these people out. I get that we want to stagger that, but I also am concerned in the quality of the work if we are overburdening employees. Sorry. Throw that.
I'm sure Mr. Melton would appreciate the support from those comments.
I understand that, but you know, it's easy when people say we're overworked, but when you understand what the actual number of caseloads are, it's different.
That's good.
Go ahead.
When Mr. Melton was here for his presentation, I was in the hospital and was unable to be here, so I wasn't part of that discussion. But it seems to me that in hiring two new attorneys, they generate additional work for others. What was the discussion there? If you hire two new attorneys, they usually have somebody that has to help them.
In terms of in-house?
Yes. Other staff?
Yeah, we received an additional legal assistant last year, I believe, and so I believe it's Mr. Melton's feeling that we're currently staffed appropriately in that regard, so, yeah.
I guess, I mean, I agree with what you're saying, but I'm sure we brought Rhonda in here, and she'd have to say, you know, talk about caseloads, you know. Everybody's got that problem, so I think this is a good solution that you came up with, you know, I think, I don't know.
Yeah, I think when the county attorney made his presentation, there's no question, I mean, when you look at the numbers compared to, you know, even our surrounding counties, that, you know, the caseload here is much more significant, but we also have the issue of trying to keep the levy down, and so to me, it looks like a reasonable resolution, at least at this point, to try and help.
I have one question, and maybe Jenny can answer it. In our placement committee that we recently created, there was some talk of backlogs in adoptions and processing on the legal side in order to get these kids out of placement. If an additional attorney was used, would that help alleviate that backlog, thus saving us money in the placements department?
It wouldn't on the adoption side, because the individuals that are adopting those children retain their private counsel, okay. So the county attorney's office doesn't do that. But where it may help, at least, would be in the actual CHIPS case, Child in Need of Protective Service case. If we are more fully staffed in the county attorney's office, we're going to be able to pay more attention to those cases. Not to say that we're not advancing them as quickly as we can now, but certainly, you know, more time will give us more availability and will give us more opportunity to pay very close attention to those timelines.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair, I'll continue then. You're aware of many of these social services requests did reduce an additional $100,000. In fact, I think it was $105,000 and some change to be exact. The sheriffs and correction reduced another $200,000. Some of it was in fuel, some of it was in the food allowance for the jail, and some of it was in the averaging of the number of beds out of county. Social services reserves were being utilized to the tune of $200,000. General fund reserves being utilized to the tune of $200,000. And this was a new one, public health reserves being utilized at the tune of $100,000. And then the departments, you see a list in here, significant ones were highway department reduced $100,000 or $60,000. He re-looked at some of the his supplies, meaning gravel and different things, and also fuel prices, and they were still a little holding high the budgeted item for fuel, and he expects that won't go quite as high as what they had expected to. Juvenile detention, that was in the new request, but I've just for clarity here that non-secure third of a position was taken out. He feels that he can possibly gain a little funding there if a bed is open or so, and gain some revenues there to make up the difference in that. You can see IT training reduction of $5,000, and then this new request was reduced $15,000. And we talked about that earlier as well. Information services, Mark had a variable hour employee in there for $3,500, and then he felt his software isn't going to run quite as high as, so he reduced that $8,000 as well. And then there's some minimal amounts. We'd already talked about the labor negotiation ones and the solid waste fee additional and some of those. So it's a variation throughout the budget that Lori and I went through and really did a close examination and tried to cut it as close as we possibly could, and there may be some fluctuation on that. There was also a little slight reduction in the MCIT contribution, and I put the premium in that's not an insurance company. It's so we can't really call it a premium and be proper, but it's a contribution. And this amount is spread throughout the different departments, so I didn't give you an exact figure there. I suppose it could certainly be of all of it. We're still working on the cell phone issues, but what we have discovered, we've gotten some responses back from other counties if they pay a per diem, or a stipends, I should say, on it, and how that works out. Some supply cells, phones for people that are dealing with the public out in the field. So we'll work through that and also bring a recommendation or at least information to you to see what you want to do with that. So as you can see, we've made some significant changes to it. And then if you go to your summary of the tax, the 2017 tax levy by funds, you will see that the spread levy is 0.5 or 5.96, and then you have a new construction growth, which helps spread that obligation out over greater properties of 1.78, which leaves you a net levy increase of 4.18. And what that does, the total suggested levy, I'm going back to that other information sheet there, the total suggested levy increase is $1.646 million. And Ms. Johnson had completed a review, let's say, of the budget and what $1.8 million would do to the budget and to a property owner, a residential, as you see down there, on a $200,000 home, that is a $52 increase, that $1.8 million. It won't quite reach that, and that's about $4.40 a month that it will increase the taxes at $1.8 million. You're going to be just slightly less than that, so it would be right around $50 a month, or $50 a year for a $200,000 residential value. And you'll see on ag land of $1 million, if it's homesteaded, it will cost about another $146 a year. I did break that down to monthly because they're usually not amortized over a monthly period like many home payments are. So anyway, certainly entertain any questions, comments, or concerns.
I have one question on labor negotiations on this page. Don't we already have the contract all settled for next year? Are we renegotiating?
Mr. Chair, we do about three a year. We have 9 labor contracts out there, and we do 3 a year, so it's constant that we negotiate every year. Yes, 2017, I think there's 3 contracts that are open for 2017, and we'll start negotiating on that. Now, have you established the rate? Well, you did with 6 of those, 3 the year prior and the 3 the year prior for that, so you've established that rate for 2017, but not on those 3 contracts. And we assume that will be the same for those. Really, what happens is 2017, 2018, you will be negotiating now for the rate for 2019 in these new contracts that are coming up. So did I make any sense on that?
Well, that wouldn't be reflected on next year's budget, but I mean, we're negotiating for 2019 now.
Right, that won't be reflected in next year's budget, no.
Mr. Chair. You're talking about the cost of being lawyers.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, we are.
I'm
sorry. No. I wasn't very clear on that.
I wasn't. I'm asking the wrong question.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah, we have budgeted
I'm thinking of contracts here. I'm talking about contracts. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. Thinking one thing and talking about another.
Well,
sorry to throw you off. Sure, thank you for your help. I needed that. Yeah.
I just have a question in regards to the West Central Minnesota Initiative. Last year, we cut that almost in half to the 8,000 what our allotment for this year. Is that a grant program? Do you recall? What exactly are we funding there?
Well, Mr. Chair and Commissioner Mojo, we cut last year, there was a $15,000 fee to them. 8 of it was going right to West Central Initiative. And yes, they use those dollars then to to match funding and different things. The $7,000 was going into Clay County's revolving loan fund, which has a balance of around $300,000, and it's not going out at the rate that the board had expected to go. So with that kind of balance, and I think the maximum amount of there is about $20,000. So there's adequate funding to there, so last year we took the $7,000 out so that we weren't building on the $300,000. But yes, the $8,000 that we give to West Central Initiative, they use for their operation of matching different grantees for a whole host of...
But are they being utilized is what my question is that are we having Clay County residents, farmers, whoever, using that on a consistent basis and to have it in, you know, I think Grant is on Land of the Dancing Sky, correct? And we're giving them about that same amount, and I don't believe any of us are on West Central. So I'm making sure if we're giving to that organization, our residents seeing the benefit. And if none of us can say that we are, then I'm wondering if it's really worth us continuing to have it as a line item.
Well, Mr. Chair, if I may respond to that, Tom Sperion, and I can't remember the other gentleman who was here from West Central Initiative, they bring in that statistical sheet to show how many, I'll say millions of dollars, has directly contributed to Clay County. So we get a...
It was just an observation.
Yeah, we get a pretty good return on our investment there. But I will get you those figures.
It's not that we completely pull it, because if we've still contributed to that revolving loan fund, there's still dollar...
No, we don't.
We're not anymore.
No, but there's a balance on it.
Oh, here.
If we have, yeah. So residents can continue to draw from that large amount.
Yes, they can.
So mm-hmm. Is it necessary for 2017 to...
Yeah, they're...
Or is it a fee that has to be paid every year in order to continue?
No, we're not putting money into that anymore.
I know, but the $8,000 goes to operations.
Yeah.
So if we pulled the $8,000, would that cease then the ability to draw from that fund?
I would say it doesn't cease to draw from the revolving loan fund. That is really a separate issue. But the $8,000 that you contribute to the West Central Initiative, I think if West Central Initiative was sitting here, they would say, well, no, we would still continue to offer services to Clay County, but would it certainly diminish the enthusiasm or the contribution that West Central Initiative reaches out and to assist in Clay County? I think it would. But I'd rather get those statistics and show...
That's fine.
So the response that they have had for Clay County. Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, we have three items here that are actually, three items here that are showing that we're taking money from reserves. And one of the, I know in Health and Human Services, we're probably not gonna see revenues over expenditures for 2016, but in past years, there's been many areas where we have had revenues over expenditures, and we don't know, and we won't know the outcome of 2016 until well after we set the budget for 2017. But there is also the possibility that there might be some areas that there were revenues over expenditures that weren't used that could be shifted to help lower the impact of some of these departments taking their reserves. I state that every year, however, we are getting closer each year to having our budget meet reality. But I just wanted to make that point. And then Commissioner Mojo, back here a few weeks ago, we talked about, you know, we're asking all of our department heads to come up with things, and she raised the question about what about all these external agencies. And I haven't seen any cuts from any of them here, but we're looking for all of our departments. What's the status on that?
Well, Mr. Chair, if I may respond on that, we certainly could reach out to those departments. I know the library, for example, is a big one. That's over around $240,000 that I think the minimum mandatory minimum is about $198,000. So, but the library asked for just a little over 2, maybe 2.5% increase, something like that. So, I mean, we could certainly go back to them and take a look at those dollars.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah, excuse me.
Regarding the library, I'm on Lake Agassiz Library Board, and they have kept it to the absolute minimum they could ask for. If it is cut back from what they've asked for, you're talking shutting down the Ulan Link site and cutting back in Holly, Barnesville, and other areas. So I would suggest that you don't touch the library. It's not going to be very pleasant.
So, Mr. Chair, I know in the past that we used to have the outside agencies come in, including the social service outside agencies, but I know Rhonda has kept those increases very to 0 or 2% or something like that. So I don't believe any of those increases
library
are,
has been
are
here.
High. What's that?
Library has been here.
You, no, oh, yes. The social service outside agencies.
Yeah. And Mr. Chair, I, to continue on that too, I think it was the Historical Society was here and their increase request was 1% this year. I think there was only one, Soil and Waters was around a 3% increase, and they were here and spoke to you or presented their budget. The other one that probably is in excess of the 3 or 4% was the Lakes and Prairies, and our senior coordinator position was about a 5% increase. So I guess the way we kind of looked at it is that these outside agencies are absorbing their health costs and their cost of living increases within that 1 and 2% that we're presenting. So, but if it's your wish to go back to those outside agencies.
I was just wondering where we were on it.
Yeah, well, that's kind of the analysis that we did on it, and they were all pretty conservative, except for the Lakes and Prairies one.
Did we change that Soil and Water at all? Because I know Kevin talked to me later on saying that he got some extra money, he could get a grant, match it with a matching fund.
We haven't changed it, but what matching was is for weed control, and I think there was maybe some conversation that would happen with the county engineer department to see if you could save dollars in that area, and it would have go back and forth. The Soil and Water meets on Thursday, and I was going to meet with Mr. Kassenberg.
Okay. Yes. That's very accurate. Thank you.
Any other further questions for her? Thank you.
Good work.
Well, we will then continue and we'll put together some resolutions for everyone who puts those together and brings the middle of the month then for your consideration, and we'll certainly welcome any other observations or input that you'd like us to do in
the meantime.
So thank you.
Okay, with that we'll bring up Dave and hearing open bids for utility work and parking lot.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you.
Eric is passing out the plan holders list. We only got one bid today. There was one electronic bid that was incomplete, and then we've got one paper bid that we're turning. I believe maybe this morning, so we'll open up the one bid. Kind of hate to see not near as many, you know, it's competition, I guess, but we'll take a look and see what we get for pure prices, and then we may need to come back and discuss with Brian and or the committee, I guess, what direction they'd like to go.
Dave, the electronic bid, you said it was not complete. That means it can't be accepted then, is that
correct? Yeah, wasn't even complete at all. There's no numbers in there or anything. I think they maybe started on it and never finished it. So this is a bid item for utility work, as well as some of the parking lot improvements over on the northwest block of the new demo sites, and all the water and sewer shutoffs for the demo homes as well. So there's 22 of those. So it's a lot of work and needs to get completed yet this fall. So it's a pretty important and crucial part of our jail project.
Just for us, we're estimating about $750,000 for that.
Correct, yeah. Houston Engineering helped us with the assembly of the plans, and they probably did the estimate as well. Is that correct?
Correct.
So hopefully their numbers are.
And Mr. Chair, just I guess for our question, this is the utility work we're talking about for under 8th Avenue as well,
yep,
as the shutoffs along 9th Avenue for all of the connections from the homes.
Correct.
And they have to tear up both streets then to do that, correct?
Nope. Well, for when they do the disconnects around the homes, they'll just, yep, do a little street patch, go down,
okay,
the main and cap them.
Okay.
But along 8th Avenue here, they're going to tear up the whole street and replace the service lines all the way out to 11th Street. Yep.
And Mr. Chair, in our discussions, we realize this is a tough time to ask for bids, and it might be a limited amount of contractors. So depending upon the amount of the bid, I think the engineers would like to look at the bid and then consider, should it be done this fall or next spring, if we could get it bid.
Is this include 10th Street?
Just the potholes, I believe, right? Out in front of,
yep,
the homes?
And I guess to kind of elaborate a little more on the parking lot work, what the plan is we're actually going to install a storm sewer, fabric and gravel and everything to final plans. So then next spring or summer, we'll just come back and pave right on top of that. So it's a temporary gravel lot in a way, but in a sense, it's not wasted, I guess, effort or money.
Are there houses on 10th Street? Anything fancy 10th Street? I don't have my map here right now, but.
Yep, there'd be homes along both sides, north, east and west of 10th.
There's houses facing 10th.
Oh. And aren't you doing anything with those, disconnecting of those yet? Is that part of it?
Just out to the curb right now, with the project that's on there right now, they're only, or maybe the sidewalk, they're going from the homes out to about the curb and gutter with the current project that's in place now. And then this project will include disconnecting from the main out to the street.
That's what I'm asking, but does it main out to the street, does it include the homes on 10th Street?
Yes.
Okay, that's what's my,
yep,
question. Okay.
All right, well, we'll open up. The one bid we have is from Key Contracting from Fargo. There was two addendums, so we'll take a look and make sure that they acknowledge both of those. First addendum acknowledged some plan sheets, and the second addendum acknowledged some rental rate things, some language that was included. There is no wage rates on this project. There's no state money, so.
Okay. The bid bond is present in the amount of 5%
in the bid.
And both addendums are acknowledged.
Okay. Like I said, the engineer's estimate was just a hair under $750,000. Grand total bid, $826,939.40. $826,939.40. At this time, Brian, do you think it would be best to maybe bring back in a week a recommendation on this, or?
Mr. Chair, I guess there's a lot of detail to this bid in talking with the engineer, so I think it would be okay if we could give him a week to evaluate it.
Okay. Jenny?
I have a question in regards to if we determine not to proceed with this fall. Does that then, we've been banking on that gravel lot for parking, that would eliminate having gravel this extra lot, correct, for
correct.
Parking?
We'd have to change gears and come up with something a little different.
Do you have a question?
That's what I was going to say anyway. Probably get that storm sewer into that lot and get a parking lot before you can mess with these guys.
Right, because then what would you do for drainage if we didn't do anything? What would you do for runoff over the winter into the spring if we didn't do
you'd
anything?
You'd have to just grade it so it comes out to the street in certain areas, I suppose.
But you'd have to. you'd have to have some sort of washout retention. You'd have to, you know, wouldn't put fabric up so it wouldn't drain into our...
Yeah. But I think it's done enough to get a parking lot in before you start tearing the leaves out.
Well, we'll go through the bid numbers, make sure they're all correct, no errors, and then we'll work with the committee a little bit. Number-wise, I guess it wasn't as alarming as I was kind of wondering. With one bid, I think we're a little over our estimate, but...
When you're in the prime of construction season, looking for additional contractors, everyone's pretty well up.
You know, and the timelines are fairly tight. You know, we don't want to get this work done this year yet, so...
Well, you know, and the time restrictions aren't going to change by spring. If you wait till spring and rebid it in the spring, you've got even a more limited time to get it done, so that you're going to have the same issues there, that contractors... Anytime you give a contractor a limited window in order to get something done, the price just seems to go up.
Yeah. Probably have less time, you're right, in the spring.
So I, you know, for us to suggest that we might get something better by spring, if we wait till spring and we rebid it in the spring, we're going to have to rebid it in the spring, but then we'll still have limited time for them to do it so that it doesn't interfere with the other work we need to do.
Correct.
The comment that Jenny made about needing that parking lot, it's critical.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't know that we're going to gain.
We're talking an over $50 million project.
Well, we're talking
$75,000 over in the what you've come.
Well, this is, it's, you know, it's roughly 10% of the over the engineer's estimate. But
yeah.
But the problem is
maybe Tom would take that out of his salary.
City of Moorhead makes you put PDF and all the holes in the street. Yeah. And that's outrageous. Especially on chemical there. You're not going to want to be there if you're digging a building. But that stuff gets so hard, you can't take it off. Well, so there's ways to get around that. So.
Do we want to contingently approve it? It is about 10% over our estimate based on no errors. You know, obviously we always do that if there's any bid items that were put together in error. That anything that we'd want to do today?
The sooner we award it, the sooner they could potentially start, depending on their schedule, I guess.
I just think that we potentially, by holding off this thing till spring, it's just puts us in another, probably in a position where something else might cost more later. And I don't want that either.
Yeah, I'll move to approve and base and come back with a
second.
Any further discussion?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, with that, we're going to committee reports. Start with Wayne this week.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On Tuesday, August 23rd, Clay County Planning Commission, general business, and then we approved a conditional use permit for a warehouse storage unit in Kurtz Township. The property is zoned agricultural general. Thursday, August 25th, Lakes and Prairies, general business, grant applications, and I will refer to Jenny regarding the property appropriations, as she's the chair of that and was much more involved in it than I was. Tuesday, August 3rd, building committee meeting. Joe Olson did an excellent job of outlining the items need to be replaced over and above what the increase is expected to pay, what the insurance rather is expected to pay for. There are areas that are nearly 60 years old and really need immediate attention. Joe has pictures and explanations for all these items. And I will pass out to you a copy of what Joe gave to us at the meeting. There are funds well over what is needed in the building improvement fund to take care of these things. The committee is recommending up to $50,000 at this time. However, we do not think the cost will be that high. The amount is recommended so the committee does not have to come back to the full board to make small increases if needed. Frank and Brian were also at the meeting and will most likely have more to add. And that is what I have, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Kevin?
We didn't take any action on
Oh, no, this is just a community report.
But that whole damage, that should be insurance.
Well, I'll let Frank and Brian cover on that. We're talking about what was exposed from the damage that has to be repaired, should be taken care of.
That wasn't that.
It wasn't caused by the water, but it's stuff that should be taken care of. It's 60 years old.
Right. Okay, just going back 2 weeks. I had the Prairie Lakes meeting, which was discussed quite a bit while Kirk was here today. That was on the 24th, so I won't go into that anymore. Then on the 25th, we had our Clay County Solid Waste meeting, and we got updates on the social media that our intern Brett Rice had been working on. Recycling updates, household hazardous waste updates, and updates from Kirk. And again, there was significant discussion about the Prairie Lakes at that meeting as well. That afternoon, we had a Metro Diversion Authority meeting, and it was a relatively small, short meeting. Most of it had to deal with going into an executive session to talk about all of the pending litigation that's going on. So and we came back and adjourned on that one. So there was not a lot to discuss there. Then Thursday, excuse me, then last week, I had an opportunity to we met with the county attorney on a jail issue, construction issue, regarding potential if there's less than three bidders in an area, how we handle that, and we wanted to make sure that that we're going to be in compliance with that. I did get an opportunity to go on two radio shows last week. One, Dave Anderson, he's a member of the MBA and also on the Public Service Commission, guest hosted a talk show and had. Brian and I went in and talked about the jail and law enforcement center project and the sales tax. And then the following day, we were on the Mike McFeely show. And then we, Brian and I and Grant and Matt Cyril also met with the editorial board of the Fargo Forum and gave a report on these projects and the sales tax. So we met with them, and there was a lot of questions, and I think it went well. And Thursday morning, we had our Clay County Joint Powers, Commissioner Mojo chairs that, so I'll let her give the report on that one. And that's it.
And you and I were on an audit meeting.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I have that here, too. We conducted the audit interview for getting going on the, or no, it was the final, it was the exit interview. Yeah, it was on the, and all went well there. We'll be getting a final report here coming up shortly. So. I don't even remember what day that was.
That was Tuesday.
That's Tuesday. Okay.
The one I was late for.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Okay, Jenny?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Last 2 weeks ago, I had the Facilities Committee to discuss some options with Lakes and Prairies in regards to Head Start space. I have the Planning Commission also that evening. Mr. Ingersoll covered that quite well. I also had Lakes and Prairies Human Resources Committee to discuss our six-month evaluation of our new executive director. That is going quite well, and we did make a motion at the general board to hire Sagency to execute that evaluation. At the general board, we had an update from Vanessa Strobel about our Child Care Aware programs. It seems to be thriving in that area, and talked about a number of grants that are that they will be applying for. One phenomenal thing is that there are, I believe, four or five of the community action professionals over there that have received a certification of accredited community, certified community action professionals. In the state, it is quite a feat to have one person in your agency that has attained that, and we have four, so that's a great thing. And we did make a motion to pursue purchasing a property in South Moorhead. I won't give you the address because of the process that needs to go through to acquire that, but it will be adding three Head Start preschool classrooms on the south side of Moorhead, which, if you recall, when Probstfield Moorhead Schools expanded, those Head Start classrooms were lost. So it is a good thing to be adding those classroom space, adding the classroom space, especially on the south side of Moorhead where there is a considerable amount of growth. Commissioner Campbell also mentioned that we have the joint powers meeting. We haven't met all summer, so it was nice to get back together. With that, we had updates on the Moorhead Public Schools building projects that are continuing to move forward. They are considerably under budget, which, as we all know, is something that is appreciated during a process like that. We did get an update from the DGF Public Schools in regards to their bonding updates. They are developing a task force of community members to re-examine what the needs and goals are for their district. There clearly was some concern with their last vote of approval, and it seems to me that they are really taking steps to address the concerns of the community. The boundary updates for Moorhead Public Schools and DGF continue. That is now sitting in St. Paul for action, and as we all know, that has not been something that happens quite easily, but they're hoping it will. We also gave an update on our correctional facility and law enforcement update, and the half-cent sales tax that we will be asking from our residents. And just a recap of everyone's budgets, and let's see, I believe that was all for that. And that also concludes my reports, Mr. Chair.
Pat? I think I had the pretty much the same ones Kevin did, the Prairie Lake Solid Waste and our Solid Waste, and the diversion meeting and the jail meeting on discussing the bidding process with the architect and our attorneys. So that was it for me.
I myself, I was at drug court that we had again. We had another graduation there, and it's very good to see what that court is doing again for our young people. Building committee, which Wayne has reported on, I guess, which we've tried to explain. I mean, yes, insurance is going to cover a lot of that stuff, but as anybody knows, I would say once you start ripping something out, sometimes you find out you should make some further improvements. And I think that's pretty much what we discussed a little bit, some of those improvements that we can make in case there is some more water damage, which it's almost like there's going to be more water damage. You know, sometimes we just can't prevent that, you know, it's probably going to happen again, and let's get prepared for it. The audit committee, again, Kevin has reported on that. Another meeting I was at, family health care. I went there for, Wayne wasn't able to make it, I went to the family health care. And I guess I would like to see, I don't know, as a group we should probably discuss, what is our purpose on the family health care? I mean, they're doing a very good job over there, but we don't contribute, they're not in our budget other than we rent to them. Is that my understanding?
I would say yes, Mr. Chair, that is a fair statement.
And I'm just trying to find out what is our purpose at any meetings there, spending per diem during the year. You know, it's almost costing us to be a member of that thing. You know, and I was just wondering whether that is a good thing, not a good, it's a good thing to be part of it. I'm not saying that. But is it necessary for us to send people there to a meeting once a month and pay per diem if we don't really, why are we going to the meetings, I guess is what I'm trying to find out. Do we discuss that, or can we, or what, Wayne, you're on the committee too, I don't know. I don't see like I'm contributing anything when I go to the meetings at times. So, yes, Brian.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I think Commissioner Mojo was asking which committee that you were talking about.
Family Healthcare.
Didn't you develop the platform for Partnership for Health? I mean, not you per se, but didn't that committee have a lot of input in those Partnership for Health?
I think Frank has a very good point. It's an excellent organization. You can't meet for what they do. But I know there are times I've been there when I have said I can't vote on this. I'm an elected official in Minnesota, and what you're asking, I just can't get involved in it. It was a North Dakota issue and whatever, and I can't see any specifics regarding that. But I think Frank has a point. That might be something this board would want to look at down the line. Brian, you probably have something to add to that.
Well, yeah, before, like I say, I have to agree with you. It's an excellent, they are doing a great job. You know, when I look at their report, you know, it's just that I'm trying to find out what I'm doing there. I don't know if you got any answer to that or not, Brian. I just
Well, I really don't, Mr. Chair, other than I think that's the consortium between North Dakota and Minnesota, correct? In the local arena here. And I, well, maybe I shouldn't say this, but I think their objective in gathering the elected officials together to be part of that committee is that they expect to possibly expand that into something different in regards to matching grant funds and stuff, and then they will maybe coming back for requests to to fund some of those things. And I think that's why they're have the local elected officials engaged and knowledgeable of what they're doing.
Well, I know we give them dental, and they plan to even expand it. I think they even expanded dental over here. So
yes,
I know we're involved there, you know, but we collect rent for the dental, you know, at a reduced rate.
Yes.
You know, I mean, that's our participation in that thing. And sometimes I feel that's our only participation in that committee, you know, and it's just, like I say, if you look at the per diem that we put in for it during the year, I don't know, it's costing us to be a member of that. So I'm just wondering whether we should have a discussion, whether we should continue sending a representative to that committee. The other thing I have is December 6th, the AMC is going to have a meeting down at Minneapolis, the Hyatt Regency. We got a meeting that day.
That's the annual meeting.
That's the AMC down AMC, right? Mm-hmm. We have a meeting that Tuesday here.
Tuesday here, yeah. Yeah, we'll have to postpone.
We
usually
probably
push it to Thursday.
I don't know if we want to go to Wednesday, Thursday,
usually push it to Thursday.
That's what we've done in the past, is reschedule for the Thursday when you get back.
Okay, well, I'll entertain a motion to move it to Thursday.
I'll make a motion to reschedule the meeting to the Thursday following the AMC.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. The December 6th meeting has been moved to December the 8th. That's all I have, Mr.
Chairman.
Yes.
I have one other issue that I wanted to raise in regards to the Prairie Lakes issue that Kirk did not talk about and I did not talk about, and it was talked about significantly at our last meeting, and that has to do with the repairs to the superheaters in that project. We are moving forward with going through litigation to try to see to it that those get that the remedy to fix those is covered by the appropriate companies. In the meantime, Otter Tail County, and that's a
That's a cost that's expected to be approximately $1 million. And in the meantime, Otter Tail County is going to be, according to their, it's not final yet, but their plans were to bond for that in with some other things in Otter Tail County, some other work that they're doing, and some capital improvement projects, to get that fixed with the idea in mind that we'd get reimbursed by this company. In the event that we were to not win through the arbitration process, then what will happen is that payment will go back to Prairie Lakes, and this is what Kirk was talking about too, and as far as being undercapitalized. We're probably starting in 2018, we'd have another payment that would have to be made, probably stretching over, they talked about maybe 10 years, so it'd be $100,000 a year that would be added to cover that bond. Right now, currently, we have, there's in the budget, there's $200,000 that's supposed to be set aside for capital improvement, so you know, the board can take a look at that, or hopefully there's going to be some things that are going to fall off that won't need to be invested in anymore too, so we'll be able to make some money. But I did want to mention what Otter Tail County's plans are in terms of, we're not going to wait around to get that thing fixed. We're going to just fix it because it needs to be fixed, with the hope then of get reimbursement from that company. But, all right, thank you.
Yes, Mr. Burke.
Taking my report. Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. Yeah, it's been 2 weeks, so I'll run through a lot of things here. Darren and I had a meeting with Dilworth. They had contacted me in regards to us assisting them with a personnel matter, and I'd asked Darren to do a little investigation there. So we had met with the chief of police and the city administrator there and gave them our results and had quite a good discussion, I think, in regards to helping them out somewhat. Darren and Georgia and I met in regards to parking on campus, asked them to put together a parking plan, and I think your action today, though, will help a great deal in alleviating some stress on that when we start on the 8th Avenue. That was going to take out about 90 spots for about 2 months to do the underground work on 8th Avenue, and if we do have that temporary lot on at North Block, that will help a great deal. So that is much appreciated. Lori and I met with Brian Green and the people from dispatch, referenced some financing issues, and because there's a grant for the 800 megahertz that you guys have been approving or have approved. You approved to advertise for it, and they were concerned about how the financing would be handling. We are the fiscal agent for that grant, and the money will flow through Lori's office, and we've got that all cleared up. Had a diversion conference call. That's a monthly meeting with some Washington contacts in regards to what they're doing on that. We had a regional administrators meeting in Manoman here a week ago Thursday. Went well. I thought we have a lot in common to discuss and discuss what action is being taken in the different locations, the building projects that we have, personnel issues, the health issues, the budgeting issues. It's we cover a lot of topics. Met with Rhonda and Susan, referenced their finance concerns and the budgets and the reserves and how they handle all that. So we had quite a conversation in regards to that. I attended the new hire orientation, which I do with every group. I think we had four last Monday. Darren, slowing down a little bit anyway. It's already been mentioned, but we met with Jenny Shmaraja from County Attorney's Office in regards to sole sourcing concern, reference the jail construction cell projects and got that straightened away. Met with Dave on the highway budget once, maybe even twice on that. We did have that exit interview, a preliminary one. The state auditor's office will be coming to the county board to give everybody the update on that exit interview in the near future. We had a meeting that's already been talked about, the basement water damage. But as was mentioned, there's a lot of things that need to be improved down there. They've gotten wet in the past, and now we need to make sure that they don't get wet in the future, because there will be some water damage into the future. I mean, whether it be some pump that fails or a busted pipe or whatever. So what we're hopefully going to do is take the sheetrock off and replace it with Marley or something like that that doesn't hold water after it gets wet or sprayed on. And then I've also had a meeting, Brian Melton, county attorney, asked to meet about office space. They are full. And the law library downstairs is right connected to them. It's in the new portion of the garden level. So he has some suggestions as to moving people around down there and possibly that function. So we're gonna wait till the library board meets so that we can have further conversation and get their input, and then move forward with possibly some movement down the basement with your approval on space. And this may entail a little different design and a little bit different wall coverings on some of those walls in the training room that now exists, which is sheetrock and wallpaper that holds in moisture when it does get wet, and it's just not a good deal. So we're going to make a lot of improvements down there. But Joe does not have the figures on it exactly. He's got approximations. He's going to be coming to the board meeting next week to bring you up to date on some prices and estimates of what we're costing. As far as the cleanup, yes, that's already been done. They're doing some testing down there and things now. I think that was completed last week. And we will move forward in a pretty rapid fashion with your approval on getting that going. So KFGO and WDAY have already been reported on. We had a safety meeting, referenced the CERT teams, and I think they're going to come to the board with that CERT teams for education of the board of what they'd like to do in regards to that, too. I think it's kind of an interesting concept for the county employees to help out in a disaster where they could go out in teams, and I think it's a real good approach. Met with Darren on some personnel matters, which are kind of always ongoing. Attended the Joint Powers Committee last Thursday morning, and Commissioner Mojo reported, gave an excellent report in regards to that. We had management team meeting, talked a lot of different topics. We had some training. We had the United Way presentation. We had a training video. We had a budget review in regards to it. Attended the Diversion Administrative Advisory Meeting on Friday, and I guess the one important factor out of that is that for you folks, that land and finance meeting, our committee meetings are changing around on their times. Have you been notified of that? Okay.
An hour earlier.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Lori and I did quite a bit of budget work this last 2 weeks, made lots of contacts, and hopefully formulated something that we'll need with your approval. So that's about it, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Anybody else? We're adjourned.